I came to UCI in 1973, and the campus was pretty new. And what attracted me here, instead of going to psychology department, which is the field in which I was trained, was the opportunity to develop this brand new interdisciplinary training program and to be able to do research across a variety of different fields. And in those days, doing interdisciplinary research and applying it to community problems was not the coin of the realm. Universities were built by attracting superstar specialists to very narrow areas and building up these pinnacles of excellence. And there wasn't so much emphasis on people working across fields. It was rather being known in a particular field. Nowadays, as you probably know, there's more and more need for people to be able to work across disciplines and to collaborate with people from different fields, because the problems we're facing are so complex you can't get an adequate handle on them just from one perspective. So what's happened in science, I mentioned that I was going to talk about some changes in science. One of the things that's happened is we're seeing the rise of larger and larger co-investigator teams. So when you look at the publications that have appeared over the last 50 years in the natural sciences, the social sciences, the humanities, this group here looked at close to 20 million papers published in scientific journals and 2.1 million patents. And they found this linear trend that the size of co-authorship networks is continually going up, up, up across these 50 years. And also they found that teams typically produce more frequently cited research than individuals, high impact, and these trends are consistent across several different fields. So what's driving this? Well, one of the things that's driving this is a kind of information explosion. And what you have here from UC Berkeley School of Information is a listing of the different units for measuring information, right? So we have the byte, we have a kilobyte, 2 kilobytes is about a typewritten page, 2 megabytes is about a high resolution photograph, gigabyte, terabyte, petabyte, exabyte, all the way to yottabyte. And what's happening is the information that we're producing, whether it's uploading photos or manuscripts, social networking, is increasing so fast that we're needing larger and larger units to measure that information. And in fact, one of the interesting issues that's cropping up is when people die, they leave their digital lives up on the internet, and it's not always the case that that information is taken down. So we're seeing this huge accumulation of information. An exabyte is a billion gigabytes, or 10 to the 18 bytes. And new stored information grew about 30% a year between 1999 and 2002. So that's a short cross-section in time. How big is 5 exabytes? If digitized with full formatting, the 17 million books in the Library of Congress contain about 136 terabytes of information. 5 exabytes of information is equivalent in size to the information contained in 37,000 new libraries the size of the Library of Congress. So we have this information explosion. And what that's causing is a kind of specialization of disciplines. You know, when the Wright brothers developed their first airplane, it was just the two of them out there at Kitty Hawk, and they put this flying machine together and they got it off the ground. To build the Boeing 787 Dreamliner, at least 30 different disciplines are needed just to design the engine. So we're having an increasing specialization of disciplines. And that means that all of you, as you learn your fields, you're having to focus on narrower and narrower slices of information, which leaves blind spots because you don't have information about a lot of other fields. So people are going into teams in order to compensate for that. In order to fill those blind spots, you work with other people that have complementary knowledge. So there's this belief in collective wisdom, and Wikipedia is a collective wisdom tool, Google is. This book is about putting knowledge together for faster discovery. There's a Center for Collective Intelligence at MIT, and the idea is that by harnessing the power of teams and crowdsourcing, and more science is being done in a crowdsourcing way these days. There's the whole field of citizen science, where people are on the internet sort of banding together, making new discoveries, even though they're not part of an academic institution. So this belief in collective wisdom is generating huge investments in team science at NIH, at private foundations. And an example is the recent initiative by NCATS, the National Center for the Advancement of Translational Science, where they have funded 60 centers around the country at about $15 million per center to fast track biomedical science into clinical practice and therapeutic innovations. And we have a clinical and translational science center here at UCI, which some of us are a part of. So across foundations and agencies, you see this huge investment in team science. And one of the reasons this is happening is we used to have a very compartmentalized map of agencies like National Institutes of Health. You know, you had the Blood, Heart, Lung Institute, you had the Cancer Institute, you had the Kidney Disorders Institute. Now we're finding that there's a shared substrate of factors that contribute to these different diseases. You can't just have one institute working on cancer or heart disease or diabetes, because these risk factors of inflammation, stress, metabolic syndrome, poor nutrition, physical inactivity, smoking, they're all contributing across the board to these multiple diseases. So there needs to be a pooling of information, a pooling of knowledge. Now, it's not always the case that people work well in teams. And some of you may be more introverted. You don't like to, you know, hang out with a lot of other people and have to learn all their jargon and languages across different majors. Some people just are more productive and creative working by themselves at their computer. They don't need all that teamwork. So it's not like we want to force everybody into teams, but at least you should be aware of some of these trends, and that there's going to be increasing pressure perhaps on you as you go through your careers to be able to collaborate with people from different fields because of this specialization of the disciplines and this explosion of information that we're coping with. So there's quite a growing field of studying interdisciplinary science and collaboration, and these are just some of the books that have come out on transdisciplinary research. And there's also an annual conference series now called The Science of Team Science. I just came back from the fourth one at Northwestern University a couple weeks ago. And The Science of Team Science is concerned with understanding and managing circumstances that facilitate or hinder the effectiveness of collaborative and often cross-disciplinary initiatives. So this group that gets together is all about trying to understand how do we do team science better, so that you don't have investments in team science that are wasted, where you don't get anything done because people are talking past each other or they're getting into fights about, you know, what's the appropriate methodology. A lot of times teams don't work out so well. So we need to understand, you know, who are the people that can work in teams well? How do we encourage that kind of activity so that it's successful? Now, there are a growing number of tools to enable people to work in teams. So the NIH Ombuds Office has this field guide that you can download for collaborative team science. And you can go to this website and get this book. And it's a very interesting book. It has prenuptial agreements for people that are thinking of working together in a team so that they know who's going to have credit for what, who's going to do the write-up, who's going to, you know, go off and go to conferences. So everything is laid out at the outset so people, you know, don't disagree along the way. You can go to this team science toolkit, and there's a whole set of resources here that enable people to do team science more effectively. You can go online and do these training modules in team science, and this was developed at Northwestern University. So you can see there's a huge investment in people being able to do team science and to facilitate it so that it's as productive and successful as possible. Now, even though we have all these tools, and I'm going to, by the way, shift this mic over to my shirt, and get a little comfortable here. So even though we have all these tools for doing team science, those are short-term aids. So a group gets a grant and they go online and they do these modules and they learn how to do team science in about, you know, five sessions. But if they come to the table with the wrong kind of values, where they don't really, they're not that inclusive of each other's perspectives, they don't really value doing team science, they wanted to get the big grant, but now they're going to go back in their silos and not work together, then it doesn't work out so well. And because people tend to be narrow in how they view the world, like all of you are trained in a particular major, and when you go into a major, you get socialized to view the world in a certain way. So if you're a biologist, you learn certain lab procedures, or if you're a criminologist, you might learn ethnographic research. And bench scientists might not even think ethnographic research is valid. So there are all kinds of disagreements as to how you're supposed to do science, and when you put people together from different fields, they often disagree. So Sir Francis Galton, who was a psychologist working in England in the 1800s, did this study where he took people to the Pall Mall commercial area in London, and he asked them to look at all the storefronts and to write down their associations of everything they saw on the storefront. So if they saw a dress or they saw a pair of shoes or whatever, they'd write their mental association on a piece of paper. And then he had them come back about a month later, the same route, do the same thing all over again. And he found that there was about an 80 to 90% correlation between what they wrote down the first time and what they wrote down on their second trip. So he came up with this idea that the mind is worn into these very deep ruts. You know, once we develop a set of associations, it's very hard to undo those and see things differently because we just kind of repeat what we did the first time around, even though it was several weeks. So in order to get people out of their conceptual ruts, we're trying to nurture a transdisciplinary orientation, and that's part of what the goal of ID Sure has been since its inception. And we know that this is a challenge posed by team science. You know, how do you get people to be able to appreciate different perspectives in their own and to integrate those? So what we mean by this orientation is a set of attributes, personal attributes, that emerge gradually over the course of your careers. So you're exposed to multiple mentors, multiple schools. When you get out with your degrees, you'll have multiple jobs, perhaps. And all of these experiences either increase or decrease your tendency to have this transdisciplinary approach, okay? So what do we mean by a transdisciplinary orientation? And you can break that out in terms of values, people's attitudes and beliefs, their behaviors, and their knowledge sets or their conceptual approaches to problems. So values that predispose a person toward acquiring a broad understanding of research and societal problems. So that's the core, the motivational core of being a transdisciplinarian. The belief that integrating concepts and methods from diverse fields is essential for achieving important scientific and societal advances. Some people don't necessarily believe that. Some people feel that the fastest route to knowledge is to drill down at the most micro nano level and understand genes or understand molecules. And if you can understand that basic level, you can explain social behavior, you can explain world conflict, etc. Sometimes we refer to that as a kind of reductionistic perspective, where everything can be reduced down to the most micro level. So the beliefs that people bring to science vary quite a bit. Other people are more expansive and inclusive, and they want to integrate across several different fields. And these beliefs can lead to attitudes that are favorable or less favorable toward participating in a science team. So if people really don't think it's that useful and they'd rather be at their own computer doing their own thing and they don't want to have to show up to center-wide colloquia to be a good center member, then that's not going to help sustain the collaborative work of the center very well. So these are values, attitudes, and beliefs. And then you've got behaviors that you can actually measure. You know, do people go to conferences outside their main field, or do they take courses like ID Sure, where they get exposed to other perspectives, or do they read journals that are different from what they're used to? So you can actually measure people's behavioral repertoire as to whether that's conducive to team collaboration or not. And finally, do people develop the conceptual skills and knowledge bases that enable them to think at multiple levels of analysis? So some of you, if you're microbiologists, may be thinking at a biological or cellular level of analysis. A criminologist might be thinking at a societal or public policy level of analysis. You try to put these together vertically from nano to societal or even global, it's a very daunting challenge. So how do we train people to develop this broad approach to science and societal problems? And I'm going to talk about that in terms of ecology as a kind of knowledge base that encourages cross-level thinking and systems thinking, because ecology and systems are perspectives that are very conducive to thinking across disciplines, and I'll explain that more as I go into this further. So in my own case, these are some of the environments that shape my research orientation and values. So I went to college at the University of Chicago, grad school at UNC North Carolina, came here in 73 to social ecology, to an interdisciplinary training program. Interdisciplinary training program had an opportunity to be a faculty member and an administrator in that program. So those are some of the environments that influenced my own academic development. And each of you can probably think of environments that affected your development up to this point in time, right? So We also talk about values. I mentioned that at the outset. And what are some values that would favor cross-disciplinary work? Well, one is being inclusive rather than exclusionary toward perspectives that you're not familiar with. Most people are kind of suspicious of anything that they're not that familiar with. That's often a human tendency. Being open-minded and tolerant and respectful toward others' points of view, which helps teamwork quite a bit. An emphasis on pluralism rather than determinism when considering the causal structure of scientific and societal problems. Do you see things as being caused in a linear way by one or two key factors, or do you see a kind of set of interacting factors that are multiple? And most complex problems in the world are embedded in systems that are very complex. So pluralistic thinking tends to be a little bit more conducive to team science than deterministic thinking. And then if you're interested in issues of sustainability and environmental justice, then some of these additional values would be very conducive to team collaboration in terms of the commitment to do that type of work. So that's what we mean by values. Now, in ID Sure, what we've done over the years is we've created a set of learning experiences, first with lectures from scholars from several different fields. So you're experiencing some of that this summer. And also, we have, in an earlier set of classes we developed for ID Sure, we put students like yourselves into groups of 4 to 5 students from different majors so that they would develop a collaborative team project. That was a full quarter course. We're not offering that right now. But the purpose of that was to do what Donald Campbell, he's a very famous research methodologist, has called the fish scale model of omniscience. And he's saying that rather than each of you mastering a particular discipline before you can do cross-disciplinary work, some faculty would tell you, you can't do meaningful cross-disciplinary work unless you master one field and then master another field, then maybe you can link them. What Campbell says is it's impossible these days to master any particular field because knowledge is exploding so fast. Nobody can master all of psychology or all of biology. So to learn how to be interdisciplinary, he advises getting students involved at the very outset, when they're undergraduates or grad students, in picking a problem, ideally at the interface of different fields. So not at the center of a field like psychology, but maybe at the border of psychology and neuroscience or criminology and neuroscience, and becoming the world's expert on that particular problem. And then by doing that, you start to pull information from a lot of different fields that are needed to understand that problem. So that's what he means by becoming a fish scale, okay, rather than a master of a particular discipline. So when we started this program in social ecology in the 70s, we had these three general cluster areas, human behavior and well-being, which is now called psychology and social behavior, criminology, law and society, community and environment, which is now called planning, policy, and design. And a fish scale would be a question like, how does the physical design of a neighborhood affect somebody's susceptibility to being victimized by crime? And there are concepts of defensible space. You can design neighborhoods and physical spaces in cities in ways that make them more prone to crime or less prone to crime. And then if they're worried about crime, or if they're actually victimized by crime, how does that affect their well-being? So if you have that interest in this overlap area here, that's what Campbell means by becoming a fish scale, understanding a particular problem and then pulling from the different fields that are relevant to that problem to understand it better. Does that make sense? Okay. So that's what he meant by this fish scale idea. So in some earlier years, these are some of the ID Sure teams where groups of 4 to 5 from different majors get together and they work on a term project where they put their majors, their disciplinary ideas and knowledge together. Now, we've actually done evaluations of ID Sure and some of those early training strategies. And this is a manuscript that was published in the American Journal of Preventive Medicine by our group here. And we actually were able to document over the course of a quarter and through the summer changes in each ID Sure cohort. We could measure these changes, you know, at the beginning of participation in ID Sure and toward the end. And we're able to see these shifts. So there are more and more efforts now to actually try to evaluate whether these kinds of educational initiatives work or they don't work in terms of promoting a transdisciplinary orientation. Now, I also mentioned conceptual skills. So it's great to have the values and the attitudes, the beliefs, and the behaviors, but Do you have a kind of conceptual approach to the world that enables you to look across levels and disciplines? And one example of that is you may think of health as a biological phenomenon, the germ theory. Somebody's exposed to a cold virus, they get a cold. You know, the microbe invades the host, they get a cold. But from a psychobiological model, what has been found is that people's psychological stress levels when they're exposed to a virus determines often whether they get the cold or not. So the level of psychological and social stress we're carrying around with us predisposes us to getting the cold or to a more or less severe cold. So we have to start thinking a little bit more broadly. It's not just the germ infecting the host, but what's going on in the host's environment that may be stressing that host. So we need these conceptual skills, and I'm going to talk about ecological systems and contextual analysis as frameworks that foster this kind of cross-level, cross-disciplinary thinking, okay? So I'm going to talk now about ecology. What do we mean by ecology? The reason I'm talking about ecology here, and some of you may or may not be familiar with that, is because it is a kind of meta-framework. It goes across disciplines, just as systems theory does. And it provides a way of thinking about scientific and societal problems in this very broad interdisciplinary perspective. So ecology is the study of relationships between organisms and their environments. And Darwin went out, Charles Darwin, and he observed how different species adapted to various kinds of environments in the Galapagos Islands. And he made detailed field observations. And he was looking at how these organisms adapt to their environmental surroundings, plant and animal species. So what we've seen in our different fields is a kind of evolution of ecological thinking. It started out in biology in the 1800s, the study of biomes, plants and animals, and how they're adapting to different climates and geographic terrains and resources. And in the 1920s, what occurred is that a group of sociologists at the University of Chicago decided to take those ecological precepts and apply them to the human community as if the human community was analogous to a biome. So the human ecosystem was like the biome that the biologists studied. And so they emphasized biological processes and also economic processes that determined whether people were prone to stress and health problems and behavioral problems in cities or not. And this is a diagram from the Chicago School of Human Ecology at the city of Chicago from the center on out to the suburbs, showing decreasing rates of disorder. And I'll talk more about that in more detail. The problem with human ecology, when you start equating human communities to a biome that would be studied in biology, the problem with that is it makes survival the fittest and different kinds of adaptive behaviors that you would see in the biome part and parcel of the human community. So if we have a company that through its economic power is able to lay claim to a prime piece of real estate in downtown Chicago, and they start doing a production process that spews carcinogenic smoke in the city, and people start getting sick, well, in a biome, anything goes, right? You know, it's survival of the fittest. In a human community or ecosystem, you have to start worrying about, well, should we regulate that? Should we try to reduce those externalized costs to the population by making the person that's producing them or the company that's producing them pay higher taxes or putting them out of business? So those kind of legal and philosophical kinds of issues were ignored by the early human ecologists, who were basically trying to make the human community analogous to a biome without reference to anything like law, regulations, environmental justice, etc. So social ecology, as it began to develop here at UCI and in some other places, brought a broader ecological kind of thinking where more disciplinary perspectives were incorporated, like social, psychological, institutional, cultural aspects of how people relate and adapt to their environments. So we're going to see this progression from bioecology to social ecology. The biological view of ecology was basically plant and animal species adapting to their physical surrounds, their physical milieu, and very much a systems process in terms of how extreme weather, climate food shortages, predators, disease would impact the size of a population. And the Chicago School of Human Ecologists said, well, let's apply these principles of adaptation to the city of Chicago and see what we find. And they developed what they called this concentric zone model of Chicago, of urban disorder. You've heard of this concentric zone model. Okay, so you know, basically what they found is that in the center of the city, the loop, and they call it the loop in Chicago because the elevated trains make a big loop in downtown Chicago. In the 1920s, this was the factory zone and what they called the zone in transition, where you had a lot of high-rise apartment buildings with low rents. So people that would come into Chicago from rural areas and they'd be migrating to Chicago would wind up in this zone in transition. And it was where they found the highest rates of disease and disorder, behavioral disorder, delinquency. And they explained that in terms of the economic dynamics of rents and people exploiting poor migrants that would come in from rural areas, and the migrants are sort of trying to adapt to urban life, so they're stressed to begin with. So you get a lot of disorder, high rates of disorder in here, and then as people pull themselves up by their bootstraps and they get into the further reaches of the city, like even out to the suburbs, you see a decrease in these negative disorders. So, for example, when they mapped male delinquency in Chicago, they would develop in each of these regions of Chicago, they would take the number of males aged 10 to 16, and that would be your base of population of males. And then over that, in the numerator, they would put the number that were cited for delinquency, truancy, any kind of acting out in society. And they found that the rates of that delinquency were highest in this zone of transition, as they called it. And then as you go out toward the suburbs, and this might be Evanston and Skokie and places like that, you get a dropping off of that delinquency rate. So this is juvenile delinquency. They also looked at schizophrenia. They looked at a lot of different disorders that they mapped across these different regions of Chicago, and they typically found this higher rate right in the middle of the city, and as you go out toward the suburbs, a lessening of that disorder, although sometimes there's a little bit of an anomaly. You got more here than here, but generally this trend held. So they said, what we have here is a kind of deterministic relationship between abnormal behavior and distance from the zone in transition, or the center of the city. And as you go away from the center of the city, the incidence of abnormal behavior drops off. So it's a deterministic, lawful relationship that they found. And it's all based on these principles of economics and biological adaptation. Now, in 1945, another human ecologist wrote a very important paper in the American Sociological Review that he titled Sentiment and Symbolism as Ecological Variables. And what Walter Fiery was saying is that it's not all about economics and people's financial interests, but what happens in a city is often about people's psychological and cultural attachment to different neighborhoods. And he gave his examples Boston. And he studied this neighborhood called Beacon Hill, and also gave example the Boston Common, which is a very prime piece of real estate that has never been commercially developed because it has a lot of associations for people, historical associations in terms of the American Revolution, and it provides a really nice open space. So they haven't built it up with all these commercial uses, which it kind of defies economic reasoning. And then you've got the north end of Boston, which is an Italian ethnic enclave. And here you've got not a very affluent part of town, but people are really highly attached to it. And if you move these people into the suburbs of Boston, they wouldn't be too comfortable or happy because they're used to a kind of way of life where they live above their shops. They have a lot of face-to-face interaction with their neighbors. So what was going on in Beacon Hill is that there was a movement in the 40s to try to bring in a lot of hotel and commercial development into Beacon Hill. And this would have brought more jobs, it would have brought more tax base into Beacon Hill. And what happened is the residents rose up, they formed a Beacon Hill Association, and they resisted this economic development. They said, we don't want it. And the reason they didn't want it is they felt that it would hurt the associations, the kind of colonial style, the kind of idyllic neighborhoods that they had. They didn't want all this commercial development. And in fact, what happened adjacent to Beacon Hill, if they hadn't resisted that development, this is what it would have looked like. And this is in west end of Boston near Beacon Hill, where they put in these high rises. So what was happening here is, against the Chicago School of Human Ecology assumptions that everything was driven by economics and biological adaptation, Fiery was saying that a lot of what happens in terms of people's relationships with their cities or environments is about culture, and it's about subjective attachment to places. And that's why you have this preservation of a certain kind of lifestyle in Beacon Hill without all that economic development, or preservation of open space here. I mean, in Orange County, we could have had another international airport south of Irvine. Instead, we have this great park, which is larger than Central Park in New York. And some would say, well, what's that about? You know, the airport would have brought a lot more business and income into the county. But people weren't crazy about it in terms of the pollution, in terms of the noise and things like that. So Fiery was emphasizing symbolic and sentimental versus solely economic functions of space. So it's not, space is not just about living conveniently close to a particular land use or building up an area so that it has more tax base, but it's preserving people's feelings about and sentiments about the place. So some limitations of early human ecology, they overemphasized economic and biological theory while ignoring culture and psychology. They neglected symbolic meanings of places to people that sometimes are more powerful than economic interests. And they failed to address externalized costs of economic production and concerns about environmental injustice. And that gets back to what I was talking about earlier in terms of the company spewing out all the smoke in the middle of Chicago and nothing being done about it except people getting sick, but the company prospers, they make more and more profit. So there's no regulation of that environmental injustice. So those were some limitations of the Chicago School. And what we know now in broader approaches to social ecology is that symbolic meanings of places have a lot of very strong emphasis or influence on how people relate to their environment. So whether it's this Hindu temple here, or the Western Wall of the temple in Jerusalem, or Mecca, or these totems in Northwest, the Vietnam Memorial, the symbolism of the president's office, even this symbol here in Australia on this soccer field telling people not to smoke. They've actually measured the power of that symbol when they go into the stands after a game, how many cigarette butts have been deposited in the stands before and after they did that intervention. We also know that if you design a trash can to look like a bird and you put an anti-litter social prompt on it about, you know, not littering, and you put this in a shopping center, and this was done in Blacksburg, Virginia by Scott Geller and his group, and you compare how much trash is put into the bird can versus the non-decorated can, significantly more pounds of trash get put into the bird can. People see it, they respond to this prompt, and their behavior follows accordingly. So environmental symbolism is really big. You could say, well, these bars on windows are basically going to keep criminals, burglars out of that house. But you could also say that when people drive by and they see those bars on windows, they start to get a cue that people are worried about crime, so maybe that area isn't so safe. And sometimes that can make areas even less safe because of that symbolism. Some companies put up a lot of cues about who works in that company. So they go into their conference room, they see pictures of themselves, they see their awards, or some of you in dorm rooms or apartments, you'll decorate your bedroom, you know, and show people what bands you like or what your political preference is. Or people even will take a cubicle in a workplace and they'll dress it up during a birthday celebration to give that cubicle a little bit more personal identity. It's not just a sea of cubicles. So symbolism is really important in how humans adapt to their environment. So that's something that the Chicago School of Human Ecology left out. When it comes to externalized costs of production, this is a production center in Texas where you've got a lot of people living in low-income apartments adjacent to that plant, and they're exposed to a lot of toxic smoke. And there's a researcher in Atlanta named Robert Bullard who has done extensive research on environmental injustice. The fact that if you go into Atlanta and you measure radon emissions in homes, and you go into the African-American communities and you compare them with the Caucasian, affluent Caucasian communities, you have much higher rates of carcinogenic radon in the minority neighborhoods. So Bullard started to coin this term, environmental racism. You know, the idea that people that don't have the wherewithal to keep out undesirable land uses are exposed to more toxins, more stressors, more carcinogens. So these concerns about environmental injustice, when we were developing the program in social ecology here at UCI, and these are some of the folks that got it going in the early days, the founder, Arnold Binder, Ralph Catalano, who's now at Berkeley in public health, Karen Rook is here today, Ellen Greenberger, Dave Marrero, who is one of our first PhD graduates. He's now an extremely well-known diabetes researcher. In fact, he's the incoming president of the American Diabetes Association. So some of our students have gone on to do some really, really good things in their fields. But this was when we were starting out. And what happened is over the course of several years, we became a program initially, and then we moved into this building we're in right now. And then now you have these other buildings. We're in three different buildings, Social Ecology 2 and Social Behavioral Science Gateway. So we involved to become a school, partly because of the growing surge of interest and demand in understanding how people relate to their environments and worries about global sustainability. So our mission statement, much like ID Sure, was to train students to analyze research and policy questions from a broad ecological perspective, you know, how organisms adapt to their environment, integrating multiple disciplines and linking basic theory and research with community problem solving, what we now today call translational research, you know, fast tracking medical discoveries into better clinical practice, for example. And so this mission is what we went before the Academic Senate when we were petitioning to become a school in order to gain their approval, gain the region's approval to make social ecology a school. And it basically grew out of the cracks at UCI. There was no academic plan for social ecology, but because of the timeliness of the subject and the fact that people in the school were, you know, accomplishing some good things in their different fields, we were able to become a school. Nowadays, we have these global worries and concerns. So we have planetary warming and environmental pollution at a global scale, worries about depleted natural resources, widening disparities among different socioeconomic, racial, religious groups. We have as much ethnic tension and racial conflict and religious conflict today as we had 100 years ago, if not more. So, you know, why haven't we made progress in stemming all those concerns about poverty and terrorism and racial conflict and religious conflict? And then we have the rise of the virtual world, the internet. For example, when Japan experienced the earthquake and tsunami, we saw immediately the effects of that on people, right? We saw on TV and on the computer the videos of the water rushing in and flooding all their cities and all that they were dealing with. So the internet actually accelerates our exposure to and our awareness of stressors. So we have all of these kind of sources of destabilization that we're dealing with. And because of that, if you go into the literature and you do a Google search on the term social ecological or ecological systems theory, what you find is there has been an upsurge in published articles that mention social ecology or social ecological systems from year 2000 on. It's almost been exponential the way it's gone up. And so when we started the program in social ecology, the term social ecology seemed kind of strange. People didn't know if that meant Greenpeace or if it was activism or it was something out of the 60s. But nowadays, social ecology has really gained a lot of traction because it refers to these broader issues of how we're going to adapt to our global environment and preserve it.